Now we have our next speaker. I'm really excited to hear what he has to say. So he has spent his entire career mixing business and politics. He ran Mexico. He was the president of Mexico from 1994 to 2000, in fact, when NAFTA was being implemented. He's currently on the board of several Fortune 500 companies, including Citigroup, Alcoa, and Procter & Gamble. He's also he also runs Yale University's Center for the Study of Globalization. So I'm sure many of you already know who he is. He is, of course, the former Mexican president, Ernesto Zedillo. So please give him a warm welcome to the stage.
Hello.
How are
welcome.
You? Good afternoon, everybody. Well, it is my great pleasure to be part of this Copenhagen summit. I noticed that the title is Made in the US. As you can see from my accent, I was not made in the USA. Right, I was made in Mexico, although part of my education took place in the USA, and in a sense, it continues to be in the USA because now I am a professor there at Yale University. It is very important how the US economy performs. And in dealing with this topic, you know, it is always tempting to say to you, okay, you want to know about the US economy in one word or in two words? And if you say in one word, I would say, good. And if you say it in two words, I would say, well, not good. And the big question that always emerges is whether there will be a smooth way to go into normal monetary policy again. Whether we will be able to see a business as usual monetary policy without incurring in a situation that could traumatize again the international financial and monetary system. Somehow it is suggestive of some of the comments that are included in the brochure of this conference that the United States is better off than Europe, which I would say, on balance, that is true. It's true, well, because the US economy has at least a labor flexibility that it is not easy to find in every country in Europe, and that gives them some particular resilience. It is true to the extent that conditions to foster innovation and entrepreneurial potential are still very significant in the United States, unlike some countries in Europe, not all of them, but some countries in Europe. I don't think that is the case vis-a-vis countries in Scandinavia. And the additional element will have to be international cooperation. Every problem we face will be better solved at a lesser cost and with much greater benefits if finally leaders get serious about honoring their commitments for consistent, ambitious, coherent international cooperation. Thank you very much.
Please have a seat over here. That was a fantastic presentation. And by the way, I wasn't made in the USA either. I want to talk a little bit about you personally. I mean, I'm sitting across from someone who's run an entire country. We're not talking about a company, we're talking about a country. Did you always know that you wanted to become president one day?
No, I'm not that silly. No. I always knew that I wanted to be in public service. You have to look for something more basic. What do you want? Why are you attracted to being president or to politics? Because you want to have power? Well, that's a very bad reason. Unfortunately, and I would blame the Harvard Business School, because I think around 1960.
You would blame the Harvard Business School.
Yeah, I would blame that, although now I have a Harvard degree, although it's honorary. I'm a doctor in law, so I have to tone down my criticism of Harvard. I was bribed by them so that I would not make jokes about them. No, but this is serious, you know. About 50 years ago or so, in 1960, Harvard started to create this concept of leadership, very much applied to the business world, and saying, okay, you come to Harvard Business School because we will teach you how to be a leader. If you tell young people that you are going to make them leaders, I think you risk making a lot of people frustrated. Because yes, the world needs leaders, but the world also needs carpenters, plumbers, masons, good football players, engineers that spend hours and hours in front of their computers, mathematicians that don't care about these ideas of leadership, and so on. So in my view, and that was my experience when I went to graduate school, I was very lucky to have as one of my mentors, but it was not only him, but others, that they will tell us, you don't come here, as they say at Harvard, to be educated to be a leader. You come here, they will speak of a few L's. They say, you come here to learn how to learn. You come here to learn how to be critic. You come here to learn how to think. That was very important. Mm. And you come here to learn how to serve.
Mm. All right, Mr. President, thank you so much for joining us at the President's
Thank you.
Institute. Thank you. That was great.